didn't I?
Joining older siblings.
She was married and had a daughter called Julie, a niece for Patricia, that was closer in age to her than she was to her own brother and sister, and so they treated each other like honorary sisters. They would all have days out together with Sister Doris and her husband Cliff, and even an occasional caravan holiday. I'm told whilst they were young, Patricia even gave Julie her first set of high heels, which her mum would buy for her, and she'll never forget that. She was over the moon. Patricia's first paid employment was at the municipal bank in Small Heath, and it was during this time that she met her future husband, David, and they married shortly after that in 1960, with Patricia only being 17 at the time. Then she set up home, as was usual, in your parents' front room, where they were welcoming their first son John shortly after in 1961, before eventually moving to their first home in Dearman Road, Small Heath, in 1963, just in time for arrival of baby number two, son Paul. Two daughters soon followed, with Tracy in 1965 and Lisa in 1967. But along with the regeneration of the area came another relocation, this time to Kellymead Road in Kitzbühel. These early years of family were difficult and at times turbulent, with extended periods of Patricia always having to manage alone with the children. But despite all of this, the children were always her ultimate priority. No matter what, she found a way to ensure that they were fed and watered, clothed and loved. Finances could be tight, I'm told, and even luxuries like electricity were intermittent, the children often spending many evenings reading under candlelight because there was no electricity. And when the children needed a bath, they would be walked down to their nan's house a few streets away each week for a good scrub. Towards the end of the 1970s, Patricia's marriage did eventually break down unreconcilably, and her only option was for a hostel to start with for her and the three youngest children. But she found work as a secretary for Hoskins Tower Works manufactures hospital equipment in Solihull, in Sparkhill, and now in her early 30s and at last having some income for herself, Patricia became that well-known, attractive, well-turned-out woman we know now. And it wasn't long before she drew the attention of some of the male workforce. One in particular was Donald Gibbs, only in his early 20s himself, but they took an instant shine for each other. As their friendship blossomed, they would make excuses to see each other at work, tend to be checking files and things like that, but once they decided on a relationship, sadly this was frowned upon by their workplace. Combined with comments from other shop floor workers about their age difference, Patricia made the decision to leave, although one of her bosses, who had a bit of a soft spot for her, still decided to send her work home with John for her to complete. Don tells me during this time, Patricia was shy initially to introduce him as her partner, telling everyone he was the man who does the shopping. Something that has fondly stuck throughout the years, even still, as in his words, he is still doing the shopping throughout all of their years together. As Patricia and Don's relationship grew and they moved to a house in Wellmead or Brewery, and the children were growing older and they left home too, marrying and having their own children, Patricia had more time available to spend with Don. She gained a new lease of life and confidence, being convinced to travel on his motorbike as she didn't drive. After much persuasion, she really did embrace it and loved it so much that they would regularly take long rides out to the country with day trips to Bournemouth or Wales. Patricia was far too much of a lady for bikers' leathers, so she would just double up on all of her clothes. But they did used to encounter a slight problem that seems to be a regular thing for Patricia, which was falling asleep. This time was riding on the back of the motorbike. Don became so worried that she might fall off that he would tie a piece of rope around her waist to keep her secure and safe. This, however, did cause a few issues when police officers would regularly pull them over, thinking that Don had kidnapped her. Something they always laughed about once it was all explained. parts of people had already applied and not to bother. But not to be deterred, John encouraged her not to give up and drove her to the head office in Solihull. Unannounced, she made her claims for the job, and they were so impressed with her spontaneity that they gave her it immediately. She really enjoyed her time with British Gas and made two new friends there, Val and Shirley, who went on to be best friends to her, with them all still meeting regularly for meals when they could and nights out, but more recently still keeping in contact by phone due to the restrictions. And then as British Gas split up, Patricia found her ideal job at the newly built Rathmans Ladies Powder Room. She appeared on the TV for the grand opening and loved to attend to the ladies who paid to enter it with towels and perfume and hospitality. Her warm personality and ease for talking to people meant she adored going to work. She would get to meet regular wealthy clients who had a personal shopper, and she got to know some of them so well that they would bring her lovely gifts each Christmas. She truly loved this job and loved talking to others about it. At home, her sons John and Paul had always tried to encourage her to travel, inviting her on many trips with them and with her grandchildren, but she always declined, being too scared to fly. But as she got older, she was finally convinced and took not a short trip, but long haul to Thailand, and afterwards another trip to Vietnam with Don. And that was it, she was hooked. Her bravery extended past just flying to when her and Don ended up once at a Bangkok taxi driver's house, having taken a slight detour. Even though Don was very suspicious and slightly worried, having read stories about Bangkok, they actually ended up joining him for a lovely evening meal in his home. Patricia even flew her alone to visit her son Paul and his wife Jean when he lived in Egypt. Although there was a slight little mishap before, despite all of the planning and packing everything, just as Patricia was due to board with her granddaughter Kaylee, she had overlooked one minor detail. Her passport had expired. As we know, Patricia is not someone who is easily deterred, so Don took her to the nearest passport agency, which happened to be in Wales, and 2 days later she was on the next flight on her own. She continued to visit Paul twice and also when he lived in Hong Kong too, and stayed for 5 weeks without hesitation when asked. I'm told she did kick up a bit of a stir with the locals though. Her pale skin, freckles and bubble perm wasn't quite the norm, but she didn't mind. In fact, she thought maybe they'd mistaken her for a celebrity, and whilst they took photos, she just smiled and waved. For Patricia's 70th birthday, she joined John and Joe and Joe's parents on another long-haul trip to Thailand. As usual, she was the first one up in the morning, checking in on everyone, making sure Joe's mum and dad were okay, they had taken their tablets and were eating their breakfast, and then she would love to spend the day people watching, and of course, sleeping on the beach. On all her trips, she was always happiest, watching the hustle and bustle, or just taking a nap wherever she felt comfortable. Sadly, in later years, Patricia's health began to suffer, and she was diagnosed with vascular dementia. Don became her full-time carer, with little break for him, and despite all of his best efforts, and after a number of falls in the home, it became apparent that Patricia would require more specialist round-the-clock care and supervision. She moved to see the Lodge Care Home in August, unfortunately in the middle of the pandemic, local to John and where Joe's parents were also residents. She found a real sense of community with these familiar faces, and although often the carers would tell John that Patricia needed to maybe look after herself rather than trying to look after all the other residents in their care home, she really seemed to fit in. Sadly, the restrictions meant that the family visits that were planned were drastically reduced, and then went on to initially Zoom calls and with some safe, heavily supervised visits later, as Patricia fell ill. Don would also try and visit every day when possible too. But it was just after Christmas that COVID tragically took hold in the nursing home, and sadly many of those residents were to pass away, including Joe's parents. Patricia also contracted COVID, and while she was still worrying for others and ensuring others were cared far more before herself, she also succumbed to this awful virus and passed away peacefully on the 26th of January, aged just 77 years. This leads us very poignantly now into our piece of reflection music, one of Patricia's favourites, where I ask you all to take some time to reflect privately and on your own personal memories of those that have been shared today. Thank you.
in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. So in sorrow, but with deep love and affection, we now commit Patricia's body to its end, to rest in peaceful sleep. May you travel safely onto the next part of your journey. When we look up in the sky, you are sunshine. You are the mist that rises on a summer morn. You are the gentle breeze that cools the autumn evening. And when the birds sing in the trees, you are their song. We cherish that we shared your life. We cherish our memories of you. With love, we leave you in peace. With respect, we bid you farewell. Thoughts of Patricia with another one of her